giving something up for Lent. It might be chocolate, it might give them vegetables. But I was coming back from an event last Wednesday night, and I was coming down Stafford Road from West Lynn, and there's a Roman Catholic church, and on their signboard it said, "Let our Lenten fast be from ugly words." And I thought that was a very powerful call for what they give up for Lent. Huh? Let's give up our ugly words and speak only kind and encouraging words to those around us. Welcome. This is God's house. He's the one who invites us here into his presence to speak to us, to transform our hearts and minds, to forgive our sins, to make things new for us. And part of that is confession and absolution. So we rise. Beloved, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. For he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear?
The Lord is a stronghold in my life.
Of whom shall I be afraid? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, your mercies are new every morning. And though we deserve only punishment, you receive us as your children and provide for all our needs of body and soul. Grant that we may heartily acknowledge your merciful goodness, give thanks for all your benefits, and serve you in willing obedience. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Oh, yeah. Christ. By grace we have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand, that we walk in them. Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
If our cup overflows with God's love, then
that maybe your cup is the way you measure God's love. It's too small. Way, way too small.
Let's say, we're building a tree house. Okay? And so which of these three would you use to measure a board to make sure it's just the right length for our tree house?
Thank you.
God sends venomous snakes to match the venom of their grumbling. God's people then recognize their sin and thank God's forgiveness. And God brings forgiveness into the lives of his people. A bronze snake is lifted up on a pole, and anyone bitten by these venomous snakes who looks at this bronze snake on a pole will live. And in our epistle reading this morning, Paul reminds us there was a time in our lives when we were just like God's people in the Old Testament reading this morning. There was a time when we were just as skinny as they were. There was a time when we too were dead in trespasses and sin. But God, because of his great love for us, made us alive in Christ. He sent his one and only Son to be lifted up on a cross, just like that bronze serpent on a pole, for our salvation. And then finally, in our gospel reading this morning, Jesus himself tells us he came into our world to be lifted up on a cross for our salvation. Again, just like that bronze snake in the wilderness. And whoever looks to the cross finds salvation in Jesus. So, beloved, let's dig deeper. Our Old Testament reading this morning comes from Numbers, the 21st chapter. Here in our reading this morning, Moses reminds us sometimes reality bites. Immediately after leaving Egypt behind, God's people find themselves in the wilderness. And the wilderness isn't a very safe or comfortable place to be. Nor is their experience with God one that's safe and comfortable either. In the great showdown with Pharaoh, God sends 10 vicious plagues to show his superiority over Egypt's gods, including Pharaoh, who made claims of divinity for himself. And then on the way out of Egypt, God appears as a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night, a sight that fills God's people with fear and awe. Then at Mount Sinai, God thunders on a mountain in fire and smoke, terrifying the people of Israel. Oh, being in God's presence, being in God's people, isn't safe and comfortable. These images of God leading his people through the wilderness aren't the images of God calling us to snuggle up in God's ever-resting arms, safe and secure from all alarms. And yet, what's really interesting is despite all of the great displays of God's power and God's provision as he leads his people through the wilderness, God's people don't seem to have much confidence at all that God will indeed lead them and get them to the promised land. It only takes 3 short verses in Exodus 15 to move from their songs of triumph after the Red Sea to their first grumbling. Talk about a short memory. And in our reading this morning, the grumbling only gets louder. And now it's not just grumbling against Moses, it's grumbling against God too. Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? There's no food, there's no water, and we detest this miserable food. Did you hear that? This complaint sounds a little bit like something Yogi Berra would say. We don't got no food and it tastes terrible too. Notice, beloved, what happens next. Immediately the Lord sent venomous snakes among the people. They bit the people and many Israelites died. Now, neither Moses, who shares this story with us, nor God ever says God sent the snakes because the people complained. And yet, that causality is simply implied. Nor does Moses or God ever describe these snakes as punishment for their grumbling. And yet, God's people certainly see it that way. They see the connection between their grumbling and the snakes. We sinned against you when we spoke against the Lord and against you. Pray the Lord will take those snakes away from us. God's people ask Moses to pray for them. And beloved, this is what Moses does best. He facilitates a conversation between God and his people. But notice, God does not give what his people ask for. They ask for God to take away the snakes. But God doesn't. The snakes are still present in their life. And the snakes are still prone to bite.
This is sometimes true for our lives as well, isn't it?
But what God gives his people is a way for healing and wholeness to come into their lives. So when the snakes bite, they don't die. Instead, they live. Then the Lord said to Moses, make a snake and put it on a pole. Anyone who's bitten can look at it and live. Deliverance sometimes comes in a most unexpected way. God's way to bring healing and wholeness into the lives of his people is to see a serpent lifted up on a pole. They must see the image of their sin. Sin that goes all the way back to another serpent who seduced Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. They must see the image of their sin lifted up on a pole so they can repent of their sin, receive God's healing, and live. And that brings us to our epistle reading this morning in Paul's letter to the Ephesians, the second chapter. Here in our reading this morning, Paul reminds us there was a time in our lives too when we were just as snake-bit as God's people in our Old Testament reading this morning. As for you, says Paul, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air. The Spirit is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were deserving of wrath. But just like in our Old Testament reading this morning, God in his mercy and grace delivers us, brings healing and wholeness into our lives in a most unexpected way. But because of his great love for us, says Paul, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It's by grace you've been saved. And so how does God make us alive in Christ? How does he bring healing and wholeness into our lives in Christ? Just like that serpent lifted up on a pole, he gives us his Son lifted up on a cross for all to see. And when we see the cross, we see our Savior who takes our sins upon himself and dies in our place. We hear our Savior speak to us from the cross, Father, forgive them, they don't know what they're doing. It's finished, he says. The price has been paid. Our salvation is accomplished. And because of Jesus lifted up on a cross, God lifts us up too. And God raised us up with Christ, says Paul, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the
incomparable riches of His grace expressed in His kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it's by grace you've been saved through faith. And this not from yourselves. It's the gift of God. Yes, beloved, we see Jesus lifted up on a cross. He is God's gift of grace in our lives. In Him, we're saved. And that brings us at last to our gospel reading this morning in John, the 3rd chapter. Here in our reading this morning, we have perhaps the best known verse in the entire Bible. Even if people can't recite it, somehow John 3:16 shows up in all kinds of public places. We see John 3:16 hoisted on posters behind home plate at baseball games and scattered throughout the stands at football games. It's etched on bracelets and necklaces. And yet, all too often, familiarity breeds contempt. So we do well to savor the verses of our gospel reading this morning, to read them carefully, and to let them sink once more deep into our hearts. Our reading this morning begins midway through our Lord's middle of the night conversation. And then Nicodemus struggles with understanding what Jesus is sharing with him. How can this be, he asks. So Jesus uses an analogy to help Nicodemus understand what he's been trying to tell him. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in Him. The serpent on the pole showed God's people their sin, and it showed them God's mercy as well. Anyone bitten by a snake who looked at that snake on a pole would be healed and live. God's people experienced God's grace when they looked at that snake lifted up on a pole. When they looked at that image of what caused their death. And Jesus says, in the very same way, He too must be lifted up, not on a pole, but on a cross. And anyone stained by sin, who sees with the eyes of faith, Jesus lifted up on a cross, that person is healed, made whole, and given the gift of eternal life. Whoever sees with the eyes of faith Jesus lifted up on a cross experiences God's mercy and grace. For just like that snake on a pole, Jesus lifted up on a cross gives us both, shows us both the reality of our sin and the reality of God's mercy and grace. He was pierced for our transgressions, says Isaiah. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on Him. And by His wounds, we're healed. Yes, Jesus is lifted up on a cross for our salvation. And that, my beloved, brings us to John 3:16. For God so loved the world. That little word so is such an important word here. The Greek word here is kutos. And this Greek word kutos can be translated, this is how God loved the world. He gave His one and only Son so that whoever believes in Him should not perish but have eternal life. So the emphasis here isn't so much on quantity. It's not about how much God loved the world. Rather, the emphasis is on methodology. It's about the way God loved the world. And just like in our Old Testament reading this morning with the snake on a pole, God's deliverance, God's healing, God's wholeness
mercy and grace comes in a most unexpected way. Jesus lifted up on a cross. For God didn't send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. Beloved, the single most important thing you see in this verse is God's love for the world. God loves the world deeply, unconditionally, wholeheartedly. And it's not just the people in this world, it's the entirety of this world. It's all of God's creation. And the way God chooses to show his love to the world is unique. He gives his Son. He gives his Son to be our Savior, to be all of creation's Savior. In the very same way God gave that snake lifted on a pole to save his people from death, so God gives his Son lifted on a cross to save us from death and give us eternal life. I'm here, says Jesus to Nicodemus, and to us. Because the God who loved his people of old still loves his people now. He sent me to tell you, to show you, to gather you up and welcome you home to life with him forever. Jesus' coming is like the bringing of a bright, bright light into a very dark place. The contrast between light and dark is intense. This is the verdict, says John. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it might be seen plainly that what they've done has been done in the sight of God. Yes, beloved, the contrast between light and dark is intense. Indeed, the coming of God's Son into our world leads to a number of contrasting realities. Condemned and saved. Believe and not believe. Stay in the darkness. Come into the light. Do evil. Do what's true. Beloved, these opposites express the sharp distinction that's created when the light of God's Son enters the darkness of our world. Just like God's people in our Old Testament reading this morning, we too are sleeping. Death is inevitable. When the serpent is lifted on a pole, whoever looked at it, whoever did not die. In the very same way, when Jesus is lifted on a cross, we see him as the gift of God's love and trust him to be our forgiveness, life, and salvation. Or we don't. We look at him and receive the gift of eternal life. Or we push him away, refuse to see him for who he is, and thus continue our lives separating from God, condemned. So, beloved, in many ways, these are hard words for us to hear. And it's all too easy to hear these words and think Jesus is somehow calling us to make a choice, calling us to choose. Will we choose to believe or won't we? But, beloved, this is much, much too simplistic. And it's not very good theology either. First of all, our reading this morning is embedded in a story where Jesus continues to engage, continues to argue with, and continues to persuade Nicodemus, who is slowly, ever so slowly, transformed over time into a believer. It doesn't happen all at once. It's not a matter of making a choice. It's a matter of Jesus
continuing to work in that person's life, slowly but surely bringing him to faith. And in John chapter 4, right after Jesus' conversation with Nicodemus here in our reading this morning, we see a Samaritan woman in a long, long conversation with Jesus. And that conversation ends with just the very, very beginning of faith. Far from where she first began, but still just the very beginning. And then there's the man born blind in John chapter 9. Oh yes, his move from darkness to light happens rather quickly in physical terms. But his move from darkness to light happens much, much more slowly in spiritual terms. So it's important for us to realize this intense contrast between believing and not believing, between darkness and light, between truth and evil, are indeed accurate descriptions of a profound reality. But they're not necessarily an accurate description of the process God uses to bring people to faith, to open their eyes to Jesus lifted on a cross and all his cross really means. Finally, our reading this morning shows us God's heart, God's longing. God's way of loving the world is to send his Son, to lift his Son on a cross to save it. Jesus, lifted on a cross, is God's expression of love and longing. Jesus, light of the world, comes to find us, comes to give us light for our path, simply because God wants us. He wants us to be with him forever. God gives his Son, lifted on a cross, for the sheer purpose of sharing life with him for all eternity. Yes, God gives us some stark contrast. Yes, there are consequences for pushing Jesus away. But John shares these contrasts with us so we can look at our lives clearly, appreciate God's gift of love that's ours in Jesus, and then live our lives fiercely confident in God's love for us in Christ. Oh, beloved, have we ever, ever been so truly, so deeply, so consistently, so wholeheartedly, so unconditionally loved and desired by someone as we are by God? No, not at all. This is the way God loved the world. He gave his Son, lifted on a cross for our salvation, that we might live with him. We rise to tell the story of our faith in the Apostles' Creed. God has made us his people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead.
those who toil, those who sin, and all the people here present to await for the Lord's great and abundant mercy. Let us pray to the Lord. and the assurance of your love in Jesus Christ. We thank you for this undeserved grace and ask you to keep us in faith until we inherit eternal salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with a smile of his favor and give you peace. We have several announcements this morning. The first King's Guild is serving dinner at your apartment this Thursday at 5:30. If you're interested in helping, reach out to Tim Peterson. Second, this Tuesday is the Women's Guild Bible study at 11. We're going to be studying Rahab. What is a prostitute doing in the scriptures? And what does she have to teach us? And then lunch will follow at noon. You can bring us that lunch for that time period. You'll also see in the bulletin this morning the form for the Easter Lily. If you want to share Easter Lily before Easter, please complete the form and turn it in. Easter breakfast will be at 9 on Easter morning, the 31st. Please bring a pastry or fruit. Everything else will be provided. Sign up is in the narthex. And finally, this next Sunday starts our